everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and this is part 3 of our July garden update. We hope you enjoy it. All right, this is a yarrow. This is a pink yarrow. It's a nice one. It doesn't get all over the place. When it first came out, it was a beautiful, almost, I want to say maybe a coral color.
Mauve
maybe. Uh-huh. And then as it continues on, it fades out, obviously. Mm-hmm. So soon I'll be chopping these heads off.
And look what else has just opened this
and
morning.
This is a brand new one that we just bought last fall. This is called a Luna. Hmm. Luna.
Wow. They were not here yesterday.
Yesterday when we were out here, there was one and a couple that were just opening. They were kind of pinkish, and we were talking about how beautiful just these buds are. Well, today it's in its full glory. We think this might be Jazzberry Jam, but for whatever reason it does not have a label on it. But if you're interested in hardy hibiscus, there are so many varieties out now, it would behoove you to get some.
Well, this is the one that was blooming yesterday, so
yes.
You can tell it's done.
Yep, one day. That's it.
So every day a brand new one comes out. It's amazing. And then that one will go to seed, but the problem with
these... all of these are waiting.
Yeah. I mean, it's just loaded with new blossoms, so we'll be experiencing new ones every day until they all bloom out. Pretty amazing, aren't they?
They are. And even with some Japanese beetle eating on it, but not much.
Nope.
Gorgeous. All hardy hibiscus are not tall like this. Here's a small one. This is called Luna Pink Swirl. And you can see it's definitely shorter, but definitely has lots of blossoms. Buds that are going to be flowers that are as beautiful as that one.
Remember when you cut back the clematis?
I did. We cut that one way back also. And seems to be really happy that we cut it back.
Mm. And then, of course, let's turn around and see...
my Liatris, perhaps?
Yeah.
See, there's one of your friends.
Yep.
We were going to move all this Liatris, and then we didn't.
Well, I must admit, this summer has been so hot and humid. I would guess of the last 30 days, we were lucky if we could get out here maybe 5.
Yeah,
it was horrible. Just
for
horrible.
Us. I mean,
for the plants.
You're in Florida, you know what it is, and you're used to it. We are just not used to it. The plants are really happy.
Let's show what you did yesterday.
Yesterday we spent weeding the strawberries. Now I had been out here at least 2 times before and taken out, for the majority what was in here was wood sorrel, which is from the clover family. It has the tiny little yellow flowers on it, and if you don't get it, it has thousands of seeds. Well, twice we've cleaned those out, and when I came out yesterday, I have a photograph I'll share with you, Rick, of what it looked like before. You couldn't even see that we had strawberries.
Yeah, I know.
There.
It was a field of sorrel.
Like 3 beds of
wood. It was a sorrowful field.
And I think somebody is still nibbling on our plants. I found 1 strawberry. Now, some of these are ever-bearing, and I know there should have been more. And some stems were bitten off, so I think it's time to spray.
Well, I offered to cover them with the netting material.
Yeah. but that's not going to help with the wood sorrel.
No.
Because it's already there. So now it's cleaned out. I sprinkled it, made sure it got enough water, and now I'm thinking maybe we'll fertilize them for next year. These are the seed pods from the wisteria blossoms. And didn't we read that wisteria was one of the poisonous plants, that you shouldn't eat it?
There's so many, I don't remember. My mind is like mush.
But this year, there's some more, it looks like beans. Uh-huh. This year we're trying to keep the walkways at least walkable, so we've been trimming.
This is full of seeds.
Mm-hmm.
And how about your compost plant?
Well, first let's look at this western sunflower. This is a native. And yesterday before I started in on the strawberry patch, I was going to kind of round these up a little bit. This is our compass plant, which was new last year, doing extremely well, very happy. They like total sun. Again, compass plants usually orient themselves in a north-south pattern. This one is in a hoop, so it can't really do totally, but there are a lot of them that are going north and south, and we'll show you our other one that is now getting a blossom on it. Now, we talk about flocks. In the spring, there's always this big thing about all these purple flowers growing along the side of the highways, and oh, isn't that phlox beautiful? That isn't phlox. That's Dame's Rocket. Phlox has five petals on it. P-H-L-O-X, phlox. And this is the time true phlox blooms, and it's also fragrant, whereas Dame's Rocket is not.
Can you spell it backwards?
No.
T-I? While we're here, I want people to see, this is just a little bit of what we pulled out yesterday. Now, we've already taken two full trailer loads to the recycling center already.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say this trailer has been one of our smartest investments.
It's old. It looks old, but it works really well.
How many trips do you think this baby has taken?
2 million, at least. We have been so pleased with the reception our free book library has had over the years. This is the third summer, I think, that we've had it. Yesterday, Rick was cutting grass, and a car pulled up, and older woman was sitting in the car, and probably her daughter came out and was looking through the books, holding them up. Do you want this one? Would you like this one? How about this one? And we noticed that we need to put some new children's books in here. I have some more chapter books I'm going to put in there for the older kids. And we have a nice variety of adult books. And when people come,
you have to clarify
they put
that.
Some in.
Mysteries and
well, they're more aimed at the interests of grown-ups, like mysteries and informational books and romance books and
I just wanted to keep this free library a family friendly here, so be careful.
Yes, dear. So we want to make it attractive, so we have a variety of plants here, and pretty soon these white hardy hibiscus are going to be blooming. Also, we've got flame grass here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And coreopsis.
Yeah, coreopsis, and guess what?
I need a bunch over here now.
Yeah, well, you have enough bunches, so I don't think that's going to be a problem.
No, it isn't. Giant fleece plant was something we'd never heard of. And when we found it at Montez Farms, we bought it, and we have divided it and moved it around in several places in our yard. It gets this tall over probably 2 months. It started probably in late May. It started growing in late May, and now you can see it's way over my head. And once it goes to blossom, It's magnificent. It has a distinct odor. It's a pleasant odor. But as the summer goes on, it gets really heavy and it flops over.
Yeah, again, I was very surprised when some of our viewers started asking, where do we get it? Where do we get it?
Mm-hmm.
And again, it's another one of those hard-to-find plants.
I don't
know why, because it's very easy to propagate.
Oh my gosh, yes it is. You've got a root, you've got propagations. So what I'll do on a cooler day is come in and I'll probably chop half of it down. I'll chop it down half of where it is.
Half of its height.
Yes, so it may reblossom in partially. It won't be as luxurious as this, but it'll look a whole lot better. This kind of looks messy once it gets to this stage. This is the giant fleece plant in its glory, and you can see how tall it is. This has not yet plopped over. So it's a nice plant to have at the back of your yard or when you need a statement piece, but realize that you're not going to see over it. And then come fall, it'll die to the ground.
Well, it reminds me of bamboo.
It does. This is a cup plant. It seems to be a native. We first heard of it when we stopped at a woman's garden and she had some. She was from Vietnam and she was familiar with them from there. The neat thing about the cup plant and why it got its name is that the leaves form around the stem and trap water. And the water thus can water itself, I guess, from the top to the bottom.
Like self-watering.
And you pointed out that the stem is
look
a
at the
perfect
stem.
Square.
That is.
It's a square. The leaves are kind of, if you touch them, they're kind of sandpapery.
That is a sturdy 1-inch square stalk.
Yep. Mm. And then the flower looks like this. Yellow, like a yellow daisy. Look to it. Has some aphids on it, but as long as they stay on there and nowhere else, that's fine. We hear a lot about buckthorn and how bad it is, and it is, but there is a variety called fine line, one word, buckthorn that stays like this. It has those very skinny little leaves on it. It does not spread in any way. The seeds, if they ever develop, are sterile. So this has been here now for several years. It's never moved beyond this.
Remember last fall we thought it was dead?
We did. But the leaves fell off and then they came back. So that's fine. But you see the cannas. I'm not going to call them canna lilies because we know they're not. Cannas that our son Sky and I planted. These were ones that we saved all year. All winter, I should say, and the hibiscus that are here are the ones that we moved from the south side of the pergola.
I see you have a tree growing behind it again.
Again, boy, that thing is persistent. We also let a lot of the milkweed come up. Once you have a milkweed plant in your garden, it will come up again. Sometimes they get kind of ugly looking. They get aphids on them, and then the ants take care of the aphids. But this is where the monarch butterflies lay their eggs.
Remember when you put your Montauk daisies in?
Yes.
This spring?
Mm-hmm.
Look at this. You could barely even tell. I mean,
right.
Some of the stalks are old, but this is doing really well.
Yes.
And look
this
one.
Yep.
I mean, you just plopped them in the ground.
Yes.
So I think you have 20 of these that are going to grace the entire front of our east berm here.
Mm-hmm.
That'll be exciting.
It will.
Oh, it has been a dry summer. I mean, even our tricolor beech tree, you can tell the stress, even though we've watered it, that hot sun has just baked the leaves.
Yep. Well, and the humidity has just been bad.
Yep.
Also, when we were transplanting those Montauk daisies, the ones we showed you before actually had roots on them. These were just the sticks themselves, no roots at all, and still they came back. So each year they will continue to flourish.
Yeah.
And if you want more, come spring.
This is
spring,
the only one that looks like it didn't do anything. But
well, except for this one.
Oh, yeah. I have a feeling they will come. And here too.
You will plant them, they will come.
You are going to have a forest of liatris and
Montauk daisies. These lilies came from a woman who was visiting with us when we were talking about garden clubs and such. And she said, I have all these lily bulbs if you'd like some. So we took some, and in the past years, they've just been buried by the grass. We never got to them. Well, this year we got to them, even though there's still grass here. But that's how beautiful they are. Glad we got to them. Prairie dock is a native plant that's unique in the fact that even if it's 100 degrees outside, if you put your hands on the leaves themselves, it feels like the leaves have been refrigerated. They're cool. That's because the roots go so deep into the ground that it pulls up the coolness of the ground. These can get 6 to 8 feet tall, but these are... This one we planted last fall, so it's pretty much of a youngster yet. We have another one over here that we moved from a shady space over here, and this is about to blossom. Again, probably next year it'll be at least this tall. As tall as these prairie coneflowers, which are also natives.
Well, I think this too, the bug bean?
No, this is Virginia Culver's root.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful plant.
It really is.
Just beautiful. And a lot of the little pollinators like these. And then this is the compass plant.
What plant is this?
This is a compass plant that has been out here now since last fall as well. So this one is just really happy here. Again, there's the flower. A lot of native plants seem to be either purple or yellow. Did you notice that?
Mm-hmm. I like all those little, what would you call them, spines?
Fuzziness to them. Fuzzy. It definitely discourages prairie animals from chewing on it. The leaves themselves are very sandpapery. And again, the leaves are supposed to align themselves north and south. Maybe.
Yeah.
Glad I'm not a pioneer and have to rely on them. Our orchard area. The peach trees are doing great. Couldn't ask for better. The apple trees were still watching. We were promised that they would have fruit this year, but when we got them, we noticed that they had already blossomed. So hopefully next year we'll get some fruit. Those are our 5-in-1, so that means 5 different apples on the same tree, because they're grafted. This year, we did a lot of trimming on the grapes, try to get them controlled and having most of their energy going to making actual grapes and not leaves. And when we finally realized we had some grapes, we wanted to protect them from the birds. The birds have had the raspberries. They're not going to get our grapes. So we covered them with our egg fabric, and it's doing a good job. It's keeping the birds off of them. It's keeping the Japanese beetles off of them too. I don't know if you noticed that. But the problem is the way we have it set up. Somehow the birds seem to get underneath there, and they get trapped in there and don't realize they can get out. So periodically we come out and chase them out. They haven't found the grapes yet, so we're okay.
Well, if I'm going to do this, I have to build a structure so that the netting isn't just resting on the leaves. That's not the best way to do it.
No, but it isn't. But
I was so hot. The weather's been so hot. This is the best I could do.
You're talking about hot.
Please don't yell at us for being imperfect gardeners, especially this summer.
Last but not least for you, Scott, Joe Pieweed. Joe Pieweed is another one of the most reliable plants. It's good for a background area, someplace where it's not going to cover up what's in front, behind it, because it does get very tall. And it will come back and be very lovely every year.
I hope you don't mind, but I had to move you a little bit to the left. Otherwise, it looked like there was an umbrella growing out of your head.
And I said, I almost wish I had an umbrella growing out of my head.
Well, they have those little hats with umbrellas. You could get one of those.
It would ruin my hair. I couldn't.
If
you enjoyed this July garden tour, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that. And if you have comments, questions, tips, we'd enjoy reading about those too. For now, stay safe, stay healthy, keep the love growing, and bye for now.
Well, you know what? This isn't the end of today, because the next job we have is digging out the garlic.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Yep. I didn't.
Maybe we could do it tomorrow.
No. Tomorrow it's going to be in the 90s.
Connect with us on YouTube.